I'm Ron Tompkins, an investigator, a physician and investigator in the field of ME-CFS, and I'm here with Rivka Solomon, someone who is most familiar, having had to live with ME-CFS for such a long time. And we're here to have a conversation. Rivka, would you like to introduce yourself?
Sure. My name is Rivka Solomon, and I am an advocate with the Massachusetts ME-CFS and FM Association. I've been a patient with ME for decades. I've been sick for 29 years, and I'm bedridden and homebound most of the time. And that's the short summary. And it's very rare for me to get to be at a conference like this. I haven't been at a conference like this for, 25 years.
Rivka, we've worked together quite a bit over the last few years. As an investigator, often we don't get to know patients and sort of their experience with the disease, and may have read about it, but don't hear it directly from someone living it and facing it every day. I know that there's a great deal of difficulty accessing the clinicians, physicians, who know a lot about ME-CFS and acquiring all the things that would make your life better. Can you just share with us just a little bit about some of your frustrations, particularly dealing with the healthcare system as it exists today?
Well, thank you. That's a very important question, and it's something that I think is relevant to all patients with this disease. So I've had this disease, as I said, for decades now, 29 years, and I would say that nothing has changed in 29 years of being sick, in that by and large, the medical community is in the dark about this disease. I would venture to guess that about 99% of people in the healthcare professions think that this disease is not real and that it's a psychological disease. So when you go to a doctor for the first time, they often will discount you or they will psychologize you and suggest treatments that are hurtful. And that's been my experience. And even if I find a doctor who believes me and trusts what the patient says, they don't have any real ideas of treatments. So by and large, I feel like it's been a nightmare for 29 years. And I feel like I've been flailing around in the dark. And I will try a variety of treatments that I cull from the internet, which all doctors, of course, say that's awful to do that. But if they don't have any treatments, my best strategy is to find out what else has worked for other patients. And I have found a few things that have helped that way. And that's it.
I just to speak on behalf of clinicians, I do know, and I would agree with you, that many default to just simply saying it's psychological and you need to deal with it and get over it, which I can only imagine how frustrating that is. But as a clinician, not having, the diagnosis is one of exclusion. It has been. It's not really a positive definition, and there's no biomarker, and there's, which is the way that many diseases started, things like Lou Gehrig's disease and multiple sclerosis, and it just hasn't happened yet for ME-CFS, but I am trusting and confident that it will. Together with that, quite frustrating for doctors because there's so few therapies that you can rationally come up with to provide as treatment. So it is frustrating from the doctor side as well. And we need to get past this nonsense with good science, medical science, and move forward.
And that won't happen until we get better funding from the NIH. So this is a plea to the NIH to please invest in clinical trials and research. But I will say, of course, the Institute of Medicine's 2015 report shifted it from a diagnosis of exclusion to, I don't know what the opposite of that is, but to a diagnosis
affirmative of... Affirmative
diagnosis. Okay, thank you. Something that's really important, I think, for all doctors to say, that they fail to say because they don't understand the disease, is that we do have an energy production impairment, and that's been verified. And so if doctors would tell patients to not push themselves when they first get sick or ever, that would be certainly more helpful than what the general sense in our society is, that you should always be pushing yourself forward. And that's what I did. I pushed myself to get a master's degree. And if I had instead rested when I first got sick, I first got sick from mono. But if I had just rested, I might have saved myself some decades of disability.
I know there are two recommendations that are provided by some individuals, and some institutions actually consider it policy, graded exercise therapy and cognitive behavior. And I just wanted to get your sense of those. You know, we've talked about don't push yourself beyond your energy envelope, but so graded exercise therapy goes well beyond that.
Thank you for bringing up graded exercise therapy and CBT, cognitive behavior therapy. So those have been extraordinarily detrimental to patients. In general, there are lots and lots of instances where patients have become disabled permanently because they physically pushed their bodies too far when they have an energy production impairment. And CBT is unhelpful if it frames the disease, if it frames the need for CBT in the light of you just need to get over your psychological barriers to exercise. If the goal of CBT is to encourage you to get over your fear of exercise, then it can be very detrimental. Great. It's interesting because the disease for me has been progressive. I used to be able to exercise in that I could go on walks, and I loved walks. Walks were like my joy in life, to be in nature. And about 10 years ago, my disease progressed and I stopped being able to walk, and now I am a part-time wheelchair user. I can walk to the bathroom and such, but I can't go on walks. And I'm like going through Whole Foods to go food shopping, I will often have to use a wheelchair.
In the first onset of your disease, there were components that really bothered you the most. But over the years, how do things evolve? How have they changed? They haven't gotten better, but even the quality of what bothers you, how has it evolved from the beginning?
Well, that's a very interesting question, because for some of us, the disease is progressive and gets worse in time, over time. And for some of us, I would say for most of us, it stays the same, but for very few of us, it gets better. For me, the disease has been progressive. So when I first got sick, I had mono, and it was just like mono, which is that I was completely incapacitated and stuck in bed and unable to function. So when I got mono, it felt like there was poison coursing through my body, through my veins, and I wasn't able to hardly move. I was completely incapacitated. And over time, that lessened some, but it stayed at a level where I was bedridden and homebound most of the time. Now, about 8 years ago, about the same time that I stopped being able to go on walks, something new happened where my muscles just are not functioning as well. And it's not deconditioning, because when it's not, I don't know what word it is, when it's not flaring up, I can walk to the bathroom or around the kitchen and cook a meal. But when it is flaring, and it seems to be flaring more and more, my muscles just aren't working properly, and I can become almost semi-paralyzed. And like my arm might not be able to work, or my legs might not be able to work. And it sounds like hyperbole, but it feels sometimes like I'm going to die. And I don't know how to say that without making it sound like hyperbole, but it's not. It feels like my body is literally shutting down. And breathing feels difficult, there's shortness of breath. And even just getting up from the bed to go to the commode, which is right next to the bed, was impossible. I needed help doing that. So.
What about your cognition?
My cognition is crap, sorry. My cognition is pretty terrible. Everybody always says that it's not, they can't tell, but like right now, talking to you, it's as if I'm talking to you through you know, thick pea soup, or like a fog over everything. I can't, it feels like it affects my vision. It feels like I have a brain injury. Like literally, it feels like that I'm like going like this to get to the sentence I want or the word I want. And we feel, historically, we have felt abandoned. And I don't think we just felt abandoned, we were abandoned. And for me to now have the opportunity to share with you some of my symptoms, what my life struggle has been like, it's just so heartwarming and so appreciative.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for saying that.